Well, silicon cells typically have an absorber layer about 200 microns. And in contrast to that, the thin film solar cells, they are typically have an absorber layer which is typically from 1 to 2 microns, maybe sometimes 4. So they are much thinner, and it means that they can be used, for example, sometimes to flexible layers. You could imagine they could be used for clothes. The thin films typically have a much higher absorption rate, which means that all the light is typically absorbed within 6 to 1,000 nanometers, so they can be very, very thin. And this is an advantage, and it means that you can take completely different methods in use for the production of these cells. One thing is that you'd need much less material, and this is important because you can use other methods, for example, vacuum-based methods, and you can also use spray methods, spray coating methods. Of course, there are the typical advantages that they are more flexible, but the main point is also that the energy payback is much smaller because you use less material. For example, that if you have silicon cell, then we are talking about a payback, energy payback time, which means the energy to produce a cell and put it up, which is of the order of years, but for most of the thin film cells, it's only a order of some months, maybe 5 to 10 months, no more. So this is a big advantage. We have to think that if we are going to provide electricity to the Earth here, then we need to have something which is where we don't spend all the energy just to produce the energy harvesting materials. And the second thing is that the price is now more or less equal to silicon, so that you can have the same power for the same amount of money. 1 kilowatt hour produced by thin films will be about the same as if it was produced by traditional silicon cells. One thing that is very important is the magnitude of the energy gap in the semiconductors. It's clear that if the gap is very small, then if you have a high energy photon, then it will just spend most of its energy for heating up the cell. And we are not really interested in heating up our cell. We want to harvest the light and not to spend it to heat. But on the other hand, if the photon energy is very small and it's below the energy gap, then it means it just passes and the photon is not absorbed. So there is an optimum magnitude for the energy gap. And of course, it also depends on the source, which is the sun. And we know that there is a kind of maximum EV. So these two factors have to really to be in agreement. And for the cells, most of the cells actually that we are using have actually an energy gap which is between 1.7 and 1 EV. Silicon has a gap about 1.1 EV and is actually at the lower side of the optimum. Whereas cadmium telluride is very good, gallium arsenide is also very good. They have a value about 1.4, which is excellent for the efficiency of the cell. And then CIGS, which is actually sold as a commercial solar cell, it is varying depending on the content of gallium. If there is a lot of gallium, then the value is 1.7. And if there's no gallium, only indium, it's about 1.1. There are two important cell types on the market for the thin films. And one is cadmium telluride, which actually was developed 30 years ago, but for some time they were not really developed further. But suddenly there was a kind of breakthrough, and now we have an efficiency around 22%, which means that they can be used. And they are simple to produce because cadmium telluride like to be formed as a compound, which is just CdTl, so it means that they are simple to grow. And this is a very big advantage that you can just put the material into vacuum chamber and you can make evaporation or sublimation and you will have a perfect cell. The drawback is that they contain cadmium, which is a heavy metal that you don't like to have everywhere in your environment. And another point is, of course, that cadmium is not so frequently found in the Earth's crust. And tellurite, it means tellurium, is actually very, very rare. And there's no chance that cadmium telluride ever can play an important role for the complete energy harvest from the sun for the Earth. But it's working and it can be sold and it's tested, so it's a robust cell. The next cell is CIDS, which means copper, indium, gallium, selenide. And it was also developed in the beginning of the 70s and people found an efficiency about 14% without doing many preparations. But gradually it developed so that we now have an efficiency about 22% and they are even commercially available as well. But the cell itself is quite complicated. In the bottom, you have a molybdenum electrode on soda lime glass. Then you have the absorber. And the absorber is of course a mixture of copper, indium, gallium and selenide. And on top of that you have a buffer layer, which is cadmium sulfide. And then you have optical layers, which are typically zinc oxide and aluminum dot, zinc oxide, AZO. And then you have optical reflectance coverage, which is typically magnesium fluoride. And it means that there are a lot of difficulties by production of these cells. Usually it's made by evaporation of four elements. You have a selenide cracker and you have evaporation crucibles for copper, indium and gallium. And then you can grow them in a vacuum chamber by evaporation. But you can also just mix them on a plate by sputtering deposition and put them into an oven with selenium so that you can add selenium. But during this process, you also need to have hydrogen selenide in the chamber, which is actually very toxic and quite unpleasant to work with. Well, the main problem with this cell, which is otherwise promising, is that we need indium and gallium. And gallium is a rare metal, and it's a byproduct by aluminum processing. And it's not so easy to get, and it does not exist as a pure metal. It's always in an oxide, so it's difficult to produce. And the second thing that is that indium is also a problem now. There's only a limited amount of indium available at the crust, and it means that sooner or later there will be no more indium for that, because indium is so important in many other applications, for example for the cell phones, where we typically need a layer which is transparent and conductive. So it's not clear if we can provide enough indium that these cells can really be widespread in their use. But it's a well-working cell and you can buy it. But the problem will be if it's going to be really widespread in its application, then there's not enough indium. We are working on a particular material, CZTS, which is actually a very new material, which was invented by a Japanese, Katagiri, about 15 years ago. And it's actually a model of CIDS, but indium and gallium are replaced by tin and zinc. And these elements are very abundant and they are non-toxic. So at least there's a very big advantage in using this material. And that will be enough to cover the full consumption of energy from the sun. The challenge is that we have these materials, but we have a lot of secondary phases. It means that we have zinc sulfide somewhere, and we have also copper tin sulfide, which is also a different one. And it's also eating some of the carriers instead of bringing them onto the electrodes. So there's a challenge there. For the moment, the best efficiency is 9.4%, but it has essentially, the efficiency has essentially been rising with about 1% per year, And maybe in 4 or 5 years, we have an efficiency of 15%, which will be necessary for commercial use.